telling the indigenous population, no, the indigenous population saw the akhlaq of the Muslim travelers, the Muslim merchants, the Muslim spiritual journeyers, and then they entered in droves into Islam. So what's different from those generations, the generation that brought our ancestors Islam, and our generation? Our generation, maybe we don't come here to make da'wah necessarily. Maybe some of us have this intention, but maybe a lot of us come for dunya. We want a degree. We want money. We want to learn how to put XYZ in our own country. We want to learn how to put XYZ in my own life.
I know.
That's why our families, so many Muslim families are falling apart, because they're doing things XYZ. I want my kid to have a good education, I'll put them in front of the TV. And then the show is good, but then the commercials like that. Or something like this. So if you follow XYZ, then we'll just follow the same snake oil as the non-Muslims. But if we follow ABC, the non-Muslims are going to see how beautiful ABC is, and then they're going to start counting ABC. And they're going to want to be like us. And there's a great historian, Ibn Khaldun, one of the great scientific minds of our ummah. He wrote very much research about human sociology and human history. And he wrote something, and he said in one of his writings that the weak nations imitate the strong nations. The weak nations imitate the strong nations. In the time when Islam was at the peak of global power, when we were a civilization to be really envied and honored, the non-Muslims, the Christians themselves, used to learn Arabic and write poetry in Arabic. They used to dress like the Muslims, like the Arabs, and like the people of Africa, North Africa. They used to dress like the people of the Mediterranean. They used to imitate the Muslims. But now we see it the other way around. The Muslims are imitating the non-Muslims. Because we think that they are strong, but actually they are weak. If we look outside, they look strong. Strong concrete, strong steel foundation on the building. Very strong, infrastructure, everything. But their dunya strong, but their akhira weak. And we want to be akhira strong and dunya strong. So if you follow, imitate somebody who's akhira weak, you are going to be akhira weak. But if you follow the teachings of Rasulullah SAW and the message that he brought from our Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we will be akhira strong and we will also be dunya strong. Because the scholars say that dunya is like a shadow. If you chase after your shadow, it will run away from you. It won't catch you. But if you run away from your shadow, the shadow will keep up with you. This is dunya. When you run after dunya, you're always going to miss it. But if you run away from dunya and not worry so much about it, then it'll come. Allah will send you dunya as you need. And this is true. Because Prophet ﷺ said, do not compete with the people of this dunya over this dunya. He said, Prophet ﷺ said, take it easy with dunya, but compete for akhirah. So competing for akhirah. Oh, my friend came to masjid once today. I'm going to go twice today. And then my friend sees me going twice. He says, I'm going to go three times. So I see him going three times, I'm going to go four times. And then we end up being there five times. And that competition is friendly competition. We help to increase each other. And we're happy to see each other better. So this is the kind of competition we want. We don't want to compete at Hakim with the Gaffer, finding up things like Brad. Brad had a degree. He was an engineer. He knew how to design cars with his own mind, his own hands. He had all of the dunya things. He had a good house, good wife, good family, everything, good job. And he was getting promoted more and more. But that was not fulfilling him, because that was all at Hakim with the Gaffer. But he felt that there was an akhirah afterwards. And he wanted to seek how I can better myself, find Allah. And so this, we already have the answers in our hands. So we just have to believe, first and foremost, that we are stronger than any of the non-Muslim methods. ABC is stronger than XYZ. And we have ABC, they have XYZ. So this is something we have to believe in. We have to believe when Allah says, "Kuntum khayra ummah," we have no doubt in this. I do not have low self-esteem as a Muslim. We should say that to ourselves. I know that I am following a way. I belong to a nation that is better than the nation of the Union Jack, better than the nation of the Stars and Stripes, better than the nation of the rising China or the rising India. All of these things are passing. They are dust in the wind. But the akhirah, the deeds that we do for akhirah, is going to be lasting if we stay on the path of the Messiah of Allah. And if we say, I am from his ummah. And we want to be from his ummah. So how do we be from his ummah? Again, there's three things. First, we invite people towards the good. Second, we discourage people from doing bad. And three, we believe in Allah. And so there are examples we can start today. We can start this journey today. We can join, make allegiance towards this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi. Asr is coming up, that in itself inviting towards good. So if you're making asr, invite others in your family to make it with you. There, you're implementing. Or if you see somebody in your family or somebody in your neighborhood doing something, you can start with your family because it's more comfortable to talk to family. If you see somebody in your family doing something that's not really good, like they're eating with their left hand when Prophet says to eat with their right hand, or they're saying bad words when Allah tells us to say "Qulu qawlan sadida," say good words, then we go and tell them, and this is forbidding the bad things, and then we continue to believe in Allah. So let's be confident that there's no nation better than us. There's no way better than us. The scientists, they have done a lot of research, alhamdulillah. But their research can only come to the conclusion X, Y, Z. But we have ABC. And maybe tomorrow scientists will find that X, Y, Z was wrong all along in ABC. This happened. People used to think the earth was flat, and if the Muslims had said, yeah, it is flat, the Quran is wrong, then when we come to the ayah of Quran and said the earth is round, we would think it's wrong. But now the science came and corroborated it. Same thing with the deen of Allah, the laws of Allah, the way of life of Rasulullah. There is already science that shows that eating with your hands is good, brushing your teeth is good, all the sunnah is good. And so that time will come, inshallah, when the scientists of the world say, oh, what the people said in those days is wrong. But what Islam said was right, and it has always been right. So we shouldn't despair. We shouldn't feel sad. We should be like Musa alayhi salam, patient. If we don't see our Islam paying off today, don't worry. Train Yusha bin Nun. Who is Yusha bin Nun? Yusha bin Nun is our little brothers and sisters. It's our children. And then when they grow up, they train the next generation. Mm-hmm. And it might be hard for us. Maybe we ourselves are just coming out of slavery. So maybe it's hard for us. So we should also be forgiving for ourselves a little bit. But inshallah, when we raise our children in a different lifestyle than we are living or we have lived, it'll be easy for them to do ABC. So let's try to get away from XYZ, but we shouldn't expect us to get totally, but at least our children will grow up with an environment of ABC. And this is why Islamic education is so important. Because some of us, maybe not here, but in our community, graduated from public school or from secular school, and they're very secular. They might be secular-minded Muslims, but they realize that I want my children to have something else. So they send their kids to LUA. Their kids grow up now making salat every day in LUA, five days a week. So they're living ABC in their madrasa. So we are training inshallah noon, and we may be Musa. We may die before we see Lexington become a Muslim city. But we want Yusha bin Nun to carry on after us. So let's start today. Start today by doing the good deeds to the best of our possibility, our best of our abilities, and to avoid bad deeds to the best of our abilities, and to encourage others to do good deeds to the best of their abilities, and to discourage them from doing bad deeds to the best of their abilities. And then at the same time, all of us together as one, قل لا إله إلا الله.
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 لا إله إلا الله. تفلحون.
And may Allah bless this gathering, and may Allah forgive us for anything that was wrong, and may Allah increase anything that was right, and may Allah make this gathering a gathering of perpetual benefit, so that it's not good for us just now that when we walk out the door, but it's good for us forever, and that even in our graves and in the akhirah. And make us sit like, may Allah bring us together like this in Firdaus al-A'la of Jannah, to sit on the carpets of Jannah. And May we be the neighbors of the prophets. And may Allah guide all of us and the people of this world. And may Allah help us to see our mistakes so that we can fix them. And may Allah make us steadfast on our victories so that we can continue on them.
Man, he can do this, right? And he didn't talk to me for a year after that. I think he was afraid. oh my gosh, she's going to make me read it. And then she's going to question me on it. You know, whereas my eldest son has never talked to me since this. You know, and my daughter yelled at me for years. But Abdullah, she's settled down in some way now. So this is good. But you have to have patience and you have to have the way the Prophet knew his people. He took the time to understand them. So he took the time to understand, the patience to understand how to approach each individual. And I got that out of the day too, because we can pick up trash and we need to be an example, but we need to know what it is that's going to influence someone else to ask us, why do you wear this on your head? Why do you do this? Why do you do that? Oh, you can answer your person in Arabic too on the phone. You know, they're just amazed at all these little tiny things. And it's our job to make people want to question us. You know, that's literally our job.
Takbir.
Signs of strength, but maybe Brother Musa or Brother Ibrahim can give us a little bit more explanations why being patient actually can be quite suffering, you know, like it's just suffering, it's painful to be patient, and how we can get out of that, and maybe a little bit introductions why trying to be patient can be so painful.
We see a lot of great patience in non-violent resistance, for example. Because if somebody's, for example, we know about the boycotts, the bus boycotts of Birmingham, Alabama, right? The African American community boycotted the buses because the buses were segregating the blacks and the whites and giving the blacks the back seat where they had to walk all the way.
Rosa Parks.
So Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King and all of the others in the community, it was more than a year, right? 15 months or more? They were walking to work, walking to the groceries, walking everywhere where it would have been easier to drive. So it was hard for them to walk, but they had slavery to do this continuously nonviolently. Another example is also in the civil rights movement when the African Americans and their friends would go and do sit-ins. Sit-ins meaning they would go to a business. Some businesses, it was illegal for a black person to sit and eat in those business, in those diners. So when the Muslim, African Americans said, you know, this is not just, let's go and sit at the counters, and they're not going to move us. The people got hurt there. There would be angry people that would punch them, spit in their faces, call them terrible names, ruin their, like, try to attack their dignity, their honor, make them snap. But they had training to be quiet. Don't say anything. Don't lash back, because if you do, that will ruin the whole thing. Stay patient. So nonviolence in these two examples requires so much patience. And so that's another thing. Patience can be an action like that, where you go and you do something that you know is going to be difficult for you and it's going to hurt you, and people are going to hurt you because of doing it, but you continue doing it. Because you know that it's the right thing to do, and Allah will reward you for it, and Allah, it will make you so beloved to Allah. And so that's something how patience can be a source of strength in difficulty.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Probably the greatest example of patience as used by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the author of Quran himself. We found in Wal Asri Inna Al Insana Lafi Khusr. إلى الذين آمنوا وعملوا